I read an article this week about faith. It was a really good article, but he started with this one comment that I loved. He said, "A very wise person once said, cupcakes were muffins that believe in miracles." See, the muffins, they had faith that God could do a miracle. Now, so interesting. I actually like muffins. I don't like cupcakes because I'm more healthy, I guess. But anyway, last time we were in Hebrews and we defined faith. We saw in Hebrews 11:1 that faith provides substance and gives evidence to the things we cannot yet see. But as we trust in God, we see that He will do it. He will bring it to pass. And faith is really the God-given ability to trust in God. See, you trust God to bring you through the situations you find yourself in. You trust that when you pray and you ask for things, God's in heaven and He's listening and He cares for you and about the things, and He's going to get these things done in your life because you prayed. Faith is not these happy feelings or emotions or working yourself up to go do something big and crazy. Faith is about trusting God. It's trusting His character, trusting in His word. It's trusting in Him because you know that He's got your best interests in mind. Now, we have to remember the context of this passage. Jewish believers, they were in danger of going back to a works-based Judaism, and because of the persecution they were facing, they wanted to go back to it. And the author is encouraging these believers to keep moving forward in your relationship with Jesus. Have endurance. Keep pressing forward. Stay close to Jesus because He is way better than anything else, what the Old Testament had to offer and what the world has to offer. And the phrase you'll see repeated throughout Hebrews 11 is by faith. By faith. By faith, a particular person trusted in God to accomplish some amazing thing, or they trusted God to bring them through a difficulty in life, or they trusted God in the mundane, everyday moments of life, or they trusted God when things weren't coming together as they had hoped, and they believed God would make it right. They had faith. By faith, they did these things. And ultimately, what they did is they looked forward to being with Him in heaven. And I want you to notice today that it was by faith that these things happened. It wasn't by money, wasn't by smarts, or by education, or by a community of friends, or wasn't by social media, or by good advertising. It wasn't because of a good motivational speaker. It wasn't because they had proper sleep, or by exercise, or by eating properly, or by good counselors, or by good negotiating skills, or by RRSPs, or a beautiful vacation squad. No, it's by faith. By faith in God. Trusting Him to do it. Trusting Him to accomplish it. Trusting that He would make good on His word. Trusting to make good on His promises. Now, I had a fun by faith moment last Sunday because there was a point where I wasn't too sure if we'd actually have a hot tub to do a baptism in the morning. It was a little bit crazy. I was freaking out a little bit. And this hot tub guy, he showed up with the hot tub and he's setting it up. And he had his phone in his front pocket of his overalls. And you know what's going to happen. He's working on the hot tub. He bends over to work on the hot tub, and bloop, the phone goes right in the hot tub. He's freaking out. Oh, my goodness, my phone. And he pulls it out right away. He's rubbing it on his pants, and he's sucking on it to get the water out, I guess. I don't know. But he was doing that. And so I was like, I felt really bad because he's freaking out because he's got another appointment to go to right after that one to get another hot tub to someone. And so he's like, how am I going to contact these people? I don't have their information. What am I going to do? Oh, my goodness. He's freaking out. And so I just pray by faith. I said, Lord, fix this guy's phone. And just then he goes, hey, it's working. And he looks up all his information that he needs, and he's like, okay, great. And then he turns it off right away just so he doesn't cause any more damage on it. So then another thing happened. After we got his phone working, then the hot tub started leaking. And there's water all over the place, all over the floor of the downstairs in the ministry center there. There's water everywhere. And I'm like, oh my goodness, we can't have this. I have to clean up all this water. Baptism's going to start soon. I'm freaking out. And he goes, okay, well, I got to get you a new tub. So we got to drain this one. So we drain it. He goes away. He gets the new tub. And he comes back. And I'm praying, like, we got to have this set up in time for the baptism. So we start filling the tub. And it doesn't work. The hot tub doesn't work. And so he's like trying to fix things. And so I go back to prayer. I go back by faith. I say, Lord, make this hot tub work. And as I say those words, he bangs the hot tub like this, and all of a sudden, it fires up. It starts working. I know, it was still cold. Adrian, thank you. It was still cold. So now that's the funny thing. I prayed, Lord, please let this hot tub heat up in time. And he didn't. The water was cold. Steve said, he's saying, God just wanted that baptism to be frozen in our memories. Yeah, see, there's a good pun for Rory, yeah. It truly was. It was one that I will never forget. But God does work like that in our lives. Not just little things, like I talked about with a phone or a hot tub, but big things as well. When we come to him by faith and ask him to intervene or do a work or fix a problem, he answers. See, we could have turned to Google that day and look up how to fix the problem, but no, our first stop should always be to God. Give God a chance to work. And what I want you to be encouraged with, strengthened with, and challenged with in your faith in God is because we're going to see many examples of people that had faith in God. First and foremost, that's where their trust was, is in God. This is where it was. It was not in anything else, but it was in God. And he was faithful to accomplish the details in their lives. And what we see is these people of faith trusting, believing in God, and hoping for something better, taking the issues of life to God, taking the details back to God to let him work it out. Now, please understand, when we go through these verse by verse, this chapter paints a pretty amazing picture of these people. It puts them in a really good light, but that's not how they lived, as we know. This chapter only points out their faith steps. It doesn't show us all the times they messed up over and over and over again, just like you and I do. But there were times that they didn't look to God and things didn't turn out too well. We can see that in Scripture. But the times that these people did look to God instead of looking to themselves, that was their success. See, their success in life, the reason they're recorded here for all to read about, just like we read last time about Enoch and Abel, Noah, Abraham, and Sarah are recorded in Hebrews 11 because they looked up to God in faith instead of looking into themselves. They looked up, and that was their success. They looked to God. That was their great step of faith. They looked to him and trusted to him. So let's look at Noah, verse 7. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. So by faith, Noah did something pretty amazing. First of all, he believed God. It says he was divinely warned of things not yet seen and that he was moved with godly fear. Now that would take a bit of faith. Imagine being warned of something you've never seen before. You've never experienced it before. You're like, what? Are you serious? How is this going to happen? See, Noah had not experienced or seen anything like God was describing. A global flood that would wipe out mankind because of the great wickedness in man's heart. The Bible says every thought of their heart was only evil continually. It's a pretty awful time to live. And God was going to deal with it, and he warned Noah about it. Now, Noah has a choice to make. Does he trust God? Does he believe what God is saying is true? And we know from the historical count in Genesis chapter 6 to 9 that Noah did believe God, and he built an ark because of the coming flood. And Genesis 6:22 is a powerful verse. It says, thus Noah did, according to all that God commanded him, so he did. Noah believed God. He took action, not trusting his own logic, his own resources. He trusted God. He could have thought, where will all the water come from? Where will I get the resources to build this boat? What's the time frame that I have to get this done in? How will the animals arrive at the ark? There's too many unknowns here, and I choose not to believe it. But he didn't. He didn't argue with God. There was no disputing. He believed it. And he obviously knew God's character, and he knew God could be trusted, and that's why he went and took some action. That belief that he has in God produced some action. It says he moved with godly fear. What this means is that he got busy because it was God saying it. There was diligence. The Greek of that phrase means that he was circumspect or that he thought carefully about it, had reverence for what God said, so it produced some really strong actions in him and some diligent actions to get busy. Now, it took him like 100 years, 120 years to build the ark. That's a long time. And we think that his helper was Enoch's son, Methuselah, the oldest man in the Bible. And his name, Methuselah, means, some of you may know it, when he dies, it will come, meaning the flood. When Methuselah dies, it will come. The flood will happen. And you could just see Noah and Methuselah like banging away on this boat. And Noah really paying close attention that Methuselah doesn't die because he's not ready yet for this. I could just see Methuselah walking like on some scaffolding, carrying some logs or something, and Noah's like, don't fall, please. The boat's not ready yet. But his actions, Noah's actions, gives substance to his faith. See, the belief is most important. Trust in God, that's the most important part of this. That's the most important aspect of faith, not the works. The works are a result of the faith. The works or the action follows the faith. And actions are the natural occurrence of faith. Actions show what our faith is in. Actions don't produce faith. They're not a substitute for faith, but they follow faith. See, if you believe something, it will be proven by your actions. Faith comes first. Trusting in God comes first. Trusting his character, trusting his promises, trusting in his word, then comes the actions. Chuck Smith says, my faith in God provokes my works for God. Just like we see with Noah. He believed God and he took action. Then it says that Noah condemned the world. And I think this means by his actions. By his actions, he condemned the world by building an ark. It's also known that he was a preacher of righteousness. 2 Peter tells us that. And so through his godly conduct, through his steps of faith, his message to the people around him, the world was condemned. And good, godly examples, they either convict the world or they condemn it. See, the people in Noah's day didn't heed his warnings. They didn't believe God was going to do what he said. Thus, they were condemned. And it says Noah was an heir of righteousness, meaning there is an inheritance of righteousness coming his way because of his faith in God. Because he trusted in God, because he had faith in God, it made him righteous. See, like I said last time, this is how God has always operated, with faith. We can't make ourselves righteous. We can't clean ourselves up to meet God. But our belief in God, our faith in God, our trust in him makes us right with him. And under the new covenant, our belief in Jesus Christ, the fact that he paid for our sins on the cross, makes us right with God. Well, now we'll look at Abraham, the man that it's recorded that he was a friend of God. And it's written that he believed God and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Verse 8, it says, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. That's crazy. By faith, he left his homeland to go somewhere, but he didn't know where he was going. See, God said in Genesis 12, get out of your own country, from your family and your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. This is when Abraham was 75 years old. He leaves his homeland. And so Abraham went out. And commentaries suggest the Greek text means it was immediate. Abraham was getting up to obey while God was still speaking. Now imagine that conversation with your mom and dad. Hey, I'm leaving. Oh, where are you going? I don't know. I'm not too sure. When are you coming back? I don't know. Not sure. Do you have a job? Not really. How are you going to provide for yourself? Oh, God will provide. How do you know when you've arrived if you don't know where you're going? God will tell me. Like, it sounds a bit bizarre, doesn't it? But Abraham went out on the promise that he would receive a land that God would give him. And we also know from Acts chapter 7, verse 2 to 4, Stephen, when he's giving this testimony, fills in some of the story for us. Verse 4 in Acts chapter 7 says, then he, Abraham, came out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Haran. And from there, when his father was dead, God moved him to this land, which you, the Israelites, now dwell in. So Abraham got up, moved out of the land he was in, but once his father died, he went to Israel to dwell there. So his obedience wasn't perfect. He made a couple of stops along the way. He didn't do exactly what God told him to do right away. He made a few stops. It wasn't perfect obedience. It was a bit delayed because of family circumstances. But the author of Hebrews doesn't mention that. He only mentions the faith. See, God called Abraham to do this, to go to a place he didn't know how to get there or where to stop. You know what? God often doesn't show us the whole picture. He tells us what to do. We see the first step. We know the first step. And once we take the first step, then God shows us the second step. And the first step's often the most difficult, but once we take it, we see the second step, then the third step, and then the next step in faith. And God does that because he delights in us trusting in him. It pleases him. It pleases him that we go back to him in faith and ask for guidance. And it's not that God enjoys us being in uncomfortable situations or putting his thumb on us and making us feel awkward. It's that he likes us looking to him, turning to him for guidance. Because his plans always, always work out better than my plans. I don't know if you've experienced this, but when I'm in control or when you're in control of your own life, there's anxiousness, nervousness, constantly thinking about the next move or the next step or how it'll make me look or what others will feel like when I do this. But when I'm trusting in God, I'm looking up instead of looking in, and the anxiety's gone. The peace is there because I'm trusting in God. He's got it. He's going to take care of me, and I trust him in that. So you let God take you through that. Look to him in faith instead of looking to yourselves. Even though we don't know how every situation will turn out or even what's around the next corner, we do know the one who's guiding us. And that should give us all the comfort that we need in life. See, we go hiking a lot, me and my family, and we love it. And when we're on a trail and there's a fork in the trail, it could go either way. My kids look back because they're usually ahead of me because they have more energy. And they look back and they say, "Dad, which way should we go?" And I kind of assess the situation, say, "Well, right or left," and I figure it out. And my kids never complain or doubt. They just say, "Okay, Dad, here we go. Let's go." They don't say, "Well, Dad, what if there's a bear on this path instead of the other path? Or what if there's a cougar on this path? Or what if the bridge is washed out from the flood?" No, they're okay with the direction I've given them. They're comfortable. They're satisfied with their guide. See, by faith, Abraham went out not knowing where he was going, but his way was sure. His path was solid because God was his guide. And that was enough for Abraham. Is it enough for you guys? Do you find yourself grabbing the steering wheel from time to time on the passenger seat? Do you have anxiety about the path that you're on? See, God knows what's around the corner. And we should be satisfied and comfortable with him as our guide. Now, I love the next verse, verse 9. It says, "By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise." So by faith, Abraham lived in the promised land as in a foreign country. He didn't own any property. He stayed in tents. And the word dwelt means resident alien, meaning he lived there, but it wasn't his home. It wasn't his permanent residence. Even though the Israelites would later get the land, Abraham didn't claim it as his own. So by faith, Abraham dwelt. By faith, Abraham hung out. Do you think it takes faith to stay put? To not do anything? To not take action? Absolutely. Sometimes that's the hardest thing to do. See, by faith he dwelt. He was trusting God would bring him where he needed him to be. And he dwelt in tents with his sons and his grandsons, meaning they were temporarily situated for three generations. That's why it says the word "with" in there. There was no permanent place to call home, no buildings, no stables for the livestock, no city for three generations. Because Abraham found his comfort in God. And he was perfectly content to wait for the good things to come after. He trusted in God. See, faith gives us sight. It shows us God's reality. God promised the land of Canaan, and Abraham lived in the land of Canaan, but he lived like a foreigner because he knew where his real home was. It was in heaven. We're going to see that as we move on. Verse 10. "For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." Abraham's not looking to build his home here or in any land. His home was in heaven with God. That's what he was waiting for by faith. The city which was built by God. This is what Abraham was waiting for. Now, waiting. He was waiting. By faith, he was waiting. Not a glorious or glamorous step of faith, is it? Not something we really praise people for at the front on a Sunday. Like, we want to call up Sandy and Joe, give them a round of applause. They've been waiting for God to bring them a baby. It hasn't happened yet, but you know what? Praise the Lord that they're waiting. Hang in there. That's not really a glamorous step of faith, is it? It doesn't have the same appeal as someone going on an adventure. See, sometimes there's these biggest steps of faith. It's just in the waiting. Waiting for God to do it. Waiting for him to daily accomplish something. Trusting and waiting for God to move in your situation because he can do it. Instead of us making the choice and doing it ourselves, that's the temptation for me all the time, to get it done, to make a decision. It seems logical. It seems right. Let's go for it. We'll just kick the door down by faith, and we'll step forward instead of waiting for God to do it, for God to open the door, for God to bring it about. See, sometimes the greatest people of faith are the ones that have patiently and quietly trusted him to accomplish the details in their lives. They wait for him to open the door, and they quietly walk through. They don't have to kick the door open. See, God is certainly capable of changing your situation and make things happen in your life. We read that in our refresh group this last week. We read in 1 Samuel 9, Saul, he's trying to find some donkeys that ran away from his dad. And he's going all over Israel looking for these donkeys and eventually leads him to Samuel, and Samuel anoints him as king of Israel. This is like a huge chapter in Israel's history, and it's led by some donkeys that were lost. Like, that's crazy. See, if God can use donkeys to get Saul where he wanted him, certainly God can do something in our situation. Maybe it's not going as fast as you'd like. Maybe it's been years that you've been praying for something. We're hoping for a change or an answer. Well, do you trust your guide? Are you comfortable with the one that's leading the way? Then trust that he's going to work it out. Have faith in God. And next is the real perfect example of someone who should have waited for God. Verse 11, by faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Now, this isn't the whole story. We know Sarah eventually judged him faithful, because the author doesn't mention the details of Genesis 15, where God told Abraham, you know, I'll make your descendants as numerous as the stars. And then that didn't happen very fast, and so Abraham and Sarah are getting old. They're getting older, and so Sarah takes things into her hands and says, you know what, take my servant Hagar, and, you know, because it wasn't happening. So Abraham and Hagar get together, and Ishmael's born, and Abraham's 86 at this time. Then, when Abraham's 99, he's pretty old, God promises Sarah will have a son. Now, they're both really old at this point. They're in their 90s. Like, that's old. No offense. But when Sarah heard this, she laughed. When she was told that she was going to have a baby, she laughed. And then she says, Abraham confronted her, why'd you laugh? And she goes, I didn't laugh. And Abraham's like, you did laugh. And he confronts her on it. She didn't believe immediately. She didn't believe God could do it. She laughed. She was physically too old. She looked with the eyes of flesh, and she saw that it was impossible. She didn't see it with the eyes of faith yet. But God strikes the mood for these two old-timers, and boom, she's pregnant. Like, she's past the age physically. She's like, that time of the month doesn't happen for her anymore. It's done. And who knows how Abraham worked? I have no idea. But whatever. But God struck the mood, and a miracle happened. A miracle happened. God did something amazing. God was faithful to his word. Genesis 21:1 says, and the Lord visited Sarah, as he said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. God did it. God did it, just like he said he would. Sarah didn't need to force anything to happen. Abraham didn't need to make it happen. God did it just like he said he would. But it was his timing, not their timing. And obviously, after she got pregnant, she had Isaac, and Sarah probably judged that God was faithful by this point. Like, wow, I had a baby in my 90s. God can be trusted. You see, first Sarah laughed in disbelief, like, there's no way that's going to happen. Then she laughed in amazement, like, wow, it really did happen. And Genesis 21:6 says they named their son Isaac, which means laughter. See, what faith comes down to is judging or understanding that God is faithful. And he's fully able to keep his promises in your life. He's faithful to keep his word, even if it looks like it's not happening yet. Even if it's not happening in your time frame, that doesn't disqualify the fact that God is faithful. God can be trusted. We don't need to push things or force things or make things happen in our lives. I really love verse 12. Let's look at it. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, I love that phrase, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. It says he's as good as dead. Now, no offense if you're here listening and you're in your 90s. It's just the Bible's reiterating the fact that Abraham was old. He wasn't young, and God still accomplished what he promised even in his old age. That doesn't hinder God. And the eyes of faith can trust the word of God. See, Abraham's descendants are many, more than can be counted. From that one son, born at a very old age, there's millions of Israelites. From Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, the 12 sons of Jacob, and millions of people in Egypt leaving for the promised land, and all of them around the world today, from one man. A son born in his 90s. It's amazing what God can accomplish when we trust him, when our faith is in him. A son was born when it's seemingly impossible. Now, verse 13 is really interesting as we consider waiting for the things of God. Let's take a look. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. They died in faith. They died trusting that God would bring them to the land he told them that he would. And notice the phrase, assured of them. Because they trusted God, they considered the promise of God. They were assured of the promises. They were sure the promises were true because it was God who was making the promises to them in their life. Now, some of your Bibles may say persuaded. Assured means to convince. They were 100% convinced of God's character and that he would bring it about. What about you? The situation you're in. Where is your trust? Are you assured that God will bring you through it? Or are you trusting in yourself? Are you looking up? Or are you looking into yourself to get it done? Now it also says they embraced the promises. As they waited for these promises to be fulfilled, they went back to the promises of God and they held on to what he had said. An embrace means to enfold in the arms. God gave them these promises and they embraced them like a big hug. They held on tightly, tightly to the things of God. And how, I wonder how many times Abraham and Sarah were talking or wondering about these promises, how many times they got discouraged because it wasn't happening in the timing they wanted. God promised us a son. They probably embraced that promise numerous times. And if they're like me, they would have doubted numerous times. They would have thought, it's not happening. Is there something wrong with me? Have I done something wrong? Why isn't this happening yet? They would have they tried to fix it themselves, just like I would have done. But then they remembered the promises, and they were convinced to continue to trust God. They were determined to trust him with the outcome. And what about you? Are you holding on to the promises of God in your situation? Or are you like a person like in the middle of the ocean in a canoe where you're just bouncing all over the place? Whoa, I just don't know what to believe or what to trust. See, we can embrace the promises of God. We can trust him to bring us safe to the other side, believing in the things we cannot yet see, but trusting our guide because we know him, trusting in his promises through our relationship with him. It says that they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth, simply meaning they knew this wasn't their home. So whether they lived in tents for three generations rather than putting nails in boards, it just didn't matter to them because it wasn't their home. Their home was in heaven. Just like verse 10 said, they were waiting for a city who's made by God. It didn't matter that they didn't have this permanent home that was decorated all perfect for the Christmas holidays. Their real home was in heaven, and they didn't get wrapped up in the things here. And you know what? Our faith is strong when we have heaven in mind, when we know something better is coming. When you have heaven in mind, the things of earth, like the song says, grow strangely dim. You know what? Not everything will be fixed here. Not everything will be made right. Not everyone will be healed of their diseases. But in heaven, you will. You will. It will. Here there will be difficulties. Jesus promised us there will be difficulties. But he also promised he's preparing a place for us. And the glory of heaven is way, way, way better than what we have here. Praise God. And when our focus, when our gaze is directed toward God, our faith is made stronger. When we look to heaven with eager expectation, we look forward to a time when everything will be made right, and that strengthens our faith for right now. And one day, our faith will be made sight. Our faith will be a reality. We'll close our eyes here, and we'll open them in heaven. Glorious day. Well, verse 14 talks about that. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Basically saying people that say they are pilgrims here, they're just passing through. It means they're waiting for something better. And ultimately, as Christians, our hope, our home, is in heaven. Our real homeland, not our home here, but our eternal home is in heaven, We're not made for this world, for this country. Our homeland is heaven. We desire it. We look for it. We seek it. We want it. We long for it. And by faith, we trust God to get us there to the other side. See, Abraham and Sarah, they're great examples of faith. People that trusted in God, even though they wavered sometimes, just like you and I. But they held on to his promises. Yes, they had times of doubt and wavering, but they looked to God and were looking forward to their real home. Verse 15 says, "And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return." Very simply, what this is saying is that Abraham could have went home to his family anytime he wanted. Anytime he wanted, he could have packed his bags and just went back to his old country. He could have went home if he desired that, but he didn't, because he trusted in God. He trusted in what God had said, and he went out, and then he waited. He waited. He hung out in the land that he was supposed to wait in. And that's what he did, waiting for God to fulfill his promises. And then finally, verse 16, "And now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them." See, they desire a heavenly country, and because that is their desire, God is not ashamed to be called their God. God loves being called your God when you trust him and you have faith in him. So if God isn't ashamed to be called their God when people trust in him and have faith in him, would that mean that God is ashamed to be called some people's God? I think so. I believe so. The way some Christians act, they say they're believers and their lives don't show it at all. They're not living for God. There's no change of action in their life. They tell me there's very little faith. And you know, faith pleases God. God is pleased. He's not ashamed of those who trust him in faith. Even when we mess up, even when we screw up, God's not disappointed. He's pleased because you're coming back to him. He's pleased because you're coming to him to look to him for help. And what Hebrews 11 shows us is these people of faith that trust God to work things out, and they were moved to take action. And we know that these people weren't perfect. They made mistakes, just like us. But when they turned their focus up instead of inward, things began to work out well for them. See, we can read through Abraham's life when he turned his focus inward and he made choices instead of looking up to God. Things didn't work out so well for him. You guys remember the story? He told his wife to lie to people numerous times, say, "You're my sister." Didn't work out so well for him when he did that. But when he turned his eyes to God, his faith was strengthened. See, turning your eyes to God, or turning your eyes to heaven, keeps your faith strong. But looking to you, it's only going to do you wrong. God is faithful to guide you through the storms of life. He guides his faith you, or to give you the steps that you need to take through all life. He'll guide us here until he calls us home to be with him in heaven. You know, yesterday we had a really busy day in our house. Kids were up early in the morning, off out of the house, and we went to this Christmas brunch later mid-morning with family, and it was a lot of fun. We had a great time with family. Then I took all the kids with a bunch of other kids to this Christmas fair, which I don't like Christmas fairs. It's not really my thing. No offense if you like Christmas fairs, but I think they're kind of lame. But no offense, though. But then we went and we cramped into this little dollar store, like me and all these kids and another guy that I was hanging out with. And the kids were just running around looking for a bunch of stuff, touching everything, pulling everything off the shelves. And it was like, ah, stop. And then we fought traffic for an hour and a half on the way home. And I could not wait to get home after that. The end of all that, I just could not wait to get home. And you know what I mean? I was thinking about it. I can't wait to get there to be at peace and to have this rest and some quiet. I was really looking forward to being there because the day was so hectic. And when we got there, it was awesome. It was so nice just to rest and be at home. And I think that gives us a glimpse of what it'll be like when we get to heaven. It'll be like, ah, we're here. We're home. And I mean, this description doesn't do it justice. It'll be amazing. It'll blow our minds. Our faith will become sight. Everything we've read about, everything we've understood, everything we've prayed about will just come into perfect focus for us. You know, these people we read about, they had faith in God. They believed him. They trusted him to get him through life and to their real heavenly home. Noah trusted God's word, and he obeyed, and he took action, even though it didn't look right or look cool. He was probably mocked by his neighbors many times, but he believed God, and he trusted him to do it. Abraham trusted God's words and obeyed and left his home and his family, not knowing where he was going. Crazy, I don't think I'd do that. But he did it. He trusted God, he believed him. Abraham and Sarah trusted God's word and found God to be faithful as always, and he gave him a son. Promise. Abraham, by faith, he dwelt. He waited for God to bring him his home. Waiting by faith. So church, where's your faith at? Do you need to trust him with something? Do you need to take some action that proves your faith? Has God called you to take a step of faith, to do something, maybe to move, or to, like we see with Eric and Tanya, or to sit still and trust him in these things and sit and soak? What is God calling you to do? He'll guide you through the current situation that you're in. Whatever it is, you can trust in him. He's proven he's faithful over and over and over again. You know, I recently read an acronym for faith. Faith means forwarding all issues to heaven. Forwarding all issues to heaven. And sometimes the greatest step of faith that we can take is simply turning to God in prayer. God, what do I do in this situation? You got to help me. I don't know what to do. Because you know what? Either you're trusting in yourself or you're trusting in God. And trusting yourself doesn't get us very far. It's filled with anxiety.